equilibrium constant. Remember, the value of equilibrium constant is independent of initial concentration. You can use 1 mole per dm cube, 0.5 mole per dm cube, you can use 11 mole per dm cube concentration. Value of K is independent of initial concentration. Its value only changes with temperature. We have said it here that position of equilibrium is sensitive to changes in temperature. So the value of K is going to be affected by temperature only, and it is not dependent on initial concentration. When we look at the value of K, say for example, value of K is 4, means it is greater than 1. Whenever we talk about a ratio and the value of that ratio is equals to 1, okay, that means rate of forward direction reaction is equals to rate of backward direction reaction. Extent of forward and backward reactions are equal. But if the value of K is equals to 4, it is greater than 1. So whenever your K is greater than 1, what does that mean? That means it is the extent of forward direction reaction which is represented by this value. More of the product is formed, more of the forward direction reaction is being taking place. So we can use value of K to measure the extent of forward direction reaction. A higher value, a greater value than 1 means forward direction reaction is taking place to a greater extent. And if you have a value of K which is less than 1, say for example it is 0.1, that means backward direction reaction is taking place to a larger extent than your backward direction reaction. If your system is in a state, or whenever your system is in a state of equilibrium and you change one of the factors which affect the equilibrium position, then the system will try to get rid of that change. For example, we are going to look at factors affecting position of equilibrium and value of K. And the first thing which I take, or the first factor which I am going to talk about, is concentration. We have done it in all of us. If you look at this equation looks familiar to you. You have done this equation so many times. Where did we do it? We have done it when we have to see manufacture of ammonia by Haber's process, right? And if I say, for example, I am going to see the effect of changing the concentration. Say, for example, I am going to increase the concentration. When I am going to increase the concentration of reactants, one of the reactants or both the reactants, what will happen? You will have more of the reactants to react together to give you more of the product. That means it is going to shift position of equilibrium. Now, increasing concentration of your reactants will affect dynamic equilibrium. Now the reaction is not going to be taking place at the same pace for both forward and the backward direction reaction. So position of equilibrium would be shifted in the forward direction till that effect is being overcome, till that extra reactant is being used up. So what will happen? Rate of forward direction reaction is going to be more, and the rate of backward direction for a little while is going to be less. So which arrows we are going to see then? This would be the longer one, and this is going to be the smaller one. Now you see, this thing is happening here. Your forward direction arrow has become bigger in size, and the backward direction arrow has become smaller in size. Why? Because increasing the concentration of reactants, more of the product is being formed, so the rate of forward direction reactions would be greater here. Position of equilibrium would be shifted towards right hand side for a while. When I am saying it is shifted towards right hand side for a while, for how long? It is going to happen in this direction until the length of both arrows becomes equal. Okay, so the system is going to adjust its equilibrium whenever there is change in concentration of your reactants. Now, instead of increasing concentration of reactant, what I do? I decrease the concentration of a product. Now, when you decrease the concentration of product, what happens? This is what was happening in your, this is what was happening in your Hebbers process. We were continuously removing ammonia. When I am removing ammonia, what happens? How we can decrease concentration? By removing it. So when I have removed it from there, now there is no product. So your reactants have to react faster. They have to react quickly to give you product so that the equilibrium can be re-established. Okay? So again, position of equilibrium would be shifted towards right hand side. So whether I increase the concentration of reactants or I decrease the concentration of product, position of equilibrium is being affected. And position of equilibrium is going to shift it towards the side where it can minimize that effect. So increasing the concentration of reactant or decreasing the concentration of product will shift position of equilibrium towards right hand side. Okay? Now if I do vice versa, if I do just opposite of it, what I am going to do now? I am going to decrease the concentration of reactants. So when I will decrease the concentration of reactants, okay, say for example, this has been decreased. So when we are going to decrease this concentration, what happens? Nitrogen is no longer on this side. So what will happen? Your ammonia will decompose and it will produce nitrogen and hydrogen. So position of equilibrium would be shifted towards the backward side. So it is going to shift position of equilibrium towards left hand side. And in this case, what happens? Your arrow for the forward direction reaction is going to be smaller and the arrow for the backward direction reaction for a little while is going to be longer till they both become of the same length, till the dynamic equilibrium is re-established. Same thing is going to be the case with your product. Instead of decreasing the concentration, I increase the concentration of product. So whenever we will increase the concentration of product, it will again shift. Now you have more of ammonia, you have less of your reactant, so it will shift position of equilibrium towards left hand side. And position of equilibrium would be shifted for a little while till equilibrium is re-established. So you need to remember, whenever concentration is being changed, changing concentration affects position of equilibrium and it is going to shift position of equilibrium towards left hand side or the right hand side depending upon where you have brought about a change. If you are increasing concentration of reactant or decreasing concentration of product, this will shift position of equilibrium towards right hand side. If you are decreasing concentration of reactant or increasing concentration of product, it will shift position of equilibrium towards left hand side. Okay? Alright, now we are going to see the effect of pressure now. Second factor which we are going to discuss is pressure. I'm going to write nitrogen plus hydrogen giving me two moles of ammonia or sulfur trioxide is giving me sulfur dioxide. Okay, now look at these two reactions which I have written and I want to see effect of pressure. Whenever we are going to look at effect of pressure, we have to see, do we have a gaseous system? Yes, it's a gaseous system. Nitrogen is a gas, hydrogen is a gas, ammonia gaseous system. Oxygen gas, sulfur dioxide is a gas and sulfur trioxide is a gas. Okay, so we are going to see effect of pressure, and I am going to refer to Boyle's law here. If you look at our Boyle's law, you have done it in physics as well as in chemistry in states of matter. Volume is inversely proportional to pressure. This is your Boyle's law. And we apply it to the gases, right? So pressure and volume are inversely proportional. If you look at the equation, and we have done this in O levels also, that number of moles of a gas can be considered equal to number of volumes here. So the volume and moles are comparable here. So when you look at here, how many volumes of your gases are present on the left hand side? 1 and 3, 4 volumes on this side and 2 volumes on that side. If you look at here, you have 1 volume plus 2 volumes, 3 volumes on this side and you have 2 volumes on that side. So I have taken 2 reactions where you have greater volume on the reactant side and you have lesser volume on the product side. We got it from the number of moles. Now when you look at this any of these 2 reactions and you increase pressure, okay, you are going to increase pressure. Now remember, when we are increasing pressure, we are not saying increase pressure of a reactant or in decrease pressure of a product. No, it's the pressure which is exerted on the system. So if you increase pressure, keeping in mind your Boyle's law, what do you expect? Whenever pressure is increased, there is a relationship which is inversely proportional relationship between pressure and volume. So when you increase pressure, volume is going to decrease. So where position of equilibrium is going to go? Increasing pressure will shift position of equilibrium towards the right hand side. It will be favored towards the side where we have lesser volume. Here we had 4 volumes, there we had 2 volumes. So it will be shifted towards the side where we have lesser volume involved. And when you look at your second reaction, here you see you have 3 volumes and there you have 2 volumes. So even in this case, it is going to be shifted towards right hand side. Okay, so increase in pressure always favors decrease in volume. Increase in pressure favors decrease in volume. What about decrease in pressure? Now if we decrease pressure, decreasing pressure will favor increase in volume, isn't it? Inverse proportion is there. So if I am going to decrease pressure, decreasing pressure is going to shift position of equilibrium towards left hand side. Gas is going to expand, it is going to occupy more volume, and that's why position of equilibrium would be shifted towards left hand side. So whenever there is decrease in pressure, it is shifting position of equilibrium towards left hand side, and whenever there is increase in pressure, it shifts position of equilibrium towards right hand side. Okay, so position of equilibrium is being affected. I have not yet talked about value of K. Okay, so if we look at concentration, changing concentration has no effect on the value of K. Value of K will remain the same. Concentration only affects position of equilibrium. Concentration does not affect value of K. When you look at your pressure, pressure does not affect value of K. It is going to affect only position of equilibrium. It will shift it towards left or right hand side, but it will not affect the value of K. Now the third factor, and the third factor is going to be catalyst. Now when we use a catalyst, what's the definition of a catalyst? A catalyst catalyst is a substance which alters the rate of reaction without itself being used up in the chemical reaction. Remember, a catalyst was needed for this reaction. If you recall the conditions of the first reaction, Hebbers process, what were the conditions? We were using 450 to 650 degrees Celsius temperature, we were using 200 atmospheric pressure, and we were using iron or iron oxide. Right? Look at this reaction. Oxygen reacting with sulfur dioxide, giving you sulfur trioxide in contact process. There was a high temperature, there was high pressure, and there was temperature, and there was a catalyst. And what was the catalyst? It was V2O5, vanadium pentoxide. The catalyst was there. So whenever we are using catalyst, remember, catalyst affects the rate of both directions of a reversible reaction. It is going to affect both directions to the same extent. It's going to increase, say for example, if it is going to increase rate of reaction by 5 times, it is going to affect the backward direction reaction by 5 times too. So it is not going to affect position of equilibrium at all. So it is only concentration and pressure which affect position of equilibrium. They do not affect the value of K. And when we look at our catalyst, it doesn't affect position of equilibrium or the value of K at all. Then comes your fourth factor, and that is your temperature. The most important one. When we look at the fourth factor, which is your temperature, now we have to keep two things in mind. We have to look at the nature of our reaction. What is the nature of our reaction? Whether our reaction is an endothermic reaction or whether it is your exothermic reaction. Say for example, if I write these two reactions. When you look at this reaction where your dinitrogen tetroxide is decomposing and giving you 2 moles of nitrogen dioxide, it is an endothermic reaction, and when nitrogen reacts with hydrogen through reversible reaction and forms ammonia, it is an exothermic reaction. So when we have to see the effect of temperature on any reaction which is your exothermic or endothermic, we have to see that the first thing is that every reaction which is a reversible reaction is going to be, it's going to be endo in one direction and exo in the other direction. When you look at this first equation where N2O4 is changing to nitrogen dioxide, it is an endothermic reaction. So the forward direction reaction is endo and the backward direction reaction is an exo. When you look at this particular reaction for Hebbers process, it is going to be exo in the forward direction reaction and it is going to be endo in the backward direction reaction. Now see, if I'm going to increase temperature. Now increasing temperature in this case for Hebbers process, I'm increasing temperature. It is your exothermic reaction in the forward direction. Increase in temperature for an exothermic reaction would always favor backward direction. It will shift position of equilibrium towards left hand side. Why backward reaction? Why left hand side? Because the left hand side is your endothermic reaction. The reverse reaction is endothermic. So increase in temperature would always favor, increase in temperature is going to favor endothermic reaction or endothermic process. Here you see, where do we have endothermic? So the increase in temperature is going to favor endothermic. So it will shift position of equilibrium towards left hand, sorry. In this case, it is going to shift it towards right hand side. And in this case, it will shift it towards left hand side. Why? Because left hand side was endo in this reaction and right hand side is endothermic in this direction. Okay, so the this reaction, right hand side is endo, and in this reaction it is left hand side. If I decrease temperature, it is going to favor what? It is going to favor exothermic reaction. Now look at this reaction, it is exothermic in the forward direction reaction. So position of equilibrium is going to shift towards right hand side. So your decrease in temperature is shifting position of equilibrium towards right hand side. For a little while, forward direction reaction or the arrow is going to be bigger and backward direction arrow is going to be smaller till the dynamic equilibrium is achieved again. In this particular case, decrease in temperature is going to favor exothermic. So decrease in temperature is going to favor your exothermic. This is your exothermic direction, so it will shift it towards left hand side. So temperature is little tricky, so you have to see it very carefully when you are doing when you are predicting to which side reaction is going to be a position of equilibrium is going to be shifted. So must remember that it is always exothermic process which is favored by decrease in temperature, and it is always endothermic process which is favored by your increase in temperature. And then once this concept is clear, you have to see whether it is going to be endo in the forward. So endo forward direction means increase in temperature will shift it towards right hand side. If endo is in the backward direction, it will shift, increase in temperature will shift it towards left hand side. Then comes effect of temperature on the value of K. You need to remember one thing. We are dealing with gaseous system, and the gaseous systems are going to show that when we have heated it, when the system is heated up, your gases are going to expand. And when the gases are going to expand, there is thermal expansion, and this thermal expansion along with change in position of equilibrium is responsible for increase in the value of K. So increasing temperature is going to change the position of equilibrium, shift the position of equilibrium, as well as it is going to affect the value of K. K is directly proportional to the temperature for an endothermic reaction, and K is inversely proportional to an temperature for an exothermic reaction. So the value of K would be higher for an endothermic reaction if temperature is increased. K would be smaller when the temperature is increased for your exothermic reaction. Okay, now I am going to make a small chart for you so that you are able to remember whatever effects we have seen so far. Position of equilibrium,
and here we have value of K. So whenever it is concentration, it is pressure, position of equilibrium is affected. Position of equilibrium is affected. There is no effect on the value of K by your concentration or by pressure. What about catalyst? Catalyst does not affect position of equilibrium. It does not affect value of K. Then comes the temperature, the last factor. And when you look at temperature, it affects the value of position of equilibrium and it affects the value of K also. Okay, so easiest way of remembering it, either you remember that it is going to be, it's going to be position of equilibrium, which is not affected by catalyst, and it's the value of K which is only affected by temperature. Simple. Or you learn it this way, your catalyst does not affect value of K as well as position of equilibrium, and your temperature is going to affect position of equilibrium as well as value of K. It's up to you how you remember it. So that's all from my side for today.